Just 2 hours ago, Allied Air Forces began an attack on military targets in Iraq and Kuwait. These attacks continue as I speak. Ground forces are not engaged. This conflict started August 2nd when the dictator of Iraq invaded a small and helpless neighbor.
Just a short time ago, you heard the president announce that coalition forces of Operation Desert Storm have begun a large-scale ground operation against Iraqi forces inside Kuwait. This phase of the combined air, land, and sea campaign has been carefully planned to force Iraq out of Kuwait with the minimum number of casualties to Allied forces.
Indeed, analysis and computer modeling indicate that chemical agents released by aerial bombing did not reach U.S. troops in Saudi Arabia. However, we have identified potential fallout concerns in southern Iraq, particularly at the rear area chemical weapons storage bunker and pit area at the location known as Al-Qamishiyah.
Our operations are designed to best protect the lives of all the coalition forces by targeting Saddam's vast military arsenal. Initial reports from General Schwarzkopf are that our operations are proceeding according to plan.
You use protective overgarments, boots, masks. I don't think you have seen a single battle scene from Desert Storm War where our troops were not in mock gear.
During our time over there, we started seeing individuals become ill with various symptoms ranging from rashes all over their bodies or their chronic explosive diarrhea, heavy bleeding accompanied with that, excruciating headaches, the bones and the joints started aching and there were night sweats and things only became worse as time progressed.
There's enough paperwork right now to prove there is a Gulf War illness and there's certain medicines that control it. And that's all they're doing right now is controlling it for a few.
Iraq did use chemical and biological munitions.
They punched us with all these different vaccines supposedly to protect us. And
the threat of biological warfare is nothing new to the military, but the Persian Gulf War placed a special...
Knowing that some of these had never been tested on humans.
We're all forced to roll up our sleeves and pull down our pants and get shots in the gluteus and in the tricep muscles of our arms.
Before the Gulf War, I could run all day and leap tall buildings at a single bound. After the Gulf War, I couldn't walk a mile.
I know for a fact I was exposed to chemical, biological, radioactive materials, experimental vaccines, experimental investigational drugs, oil well fires.
I am considered a disabled veteran. I've got a 40% disability from the United States Department of Veteran Affairs for combat injuries caused by depleted uranium and other exposures.
Challenge to join the elite. And if you succeed, if you can master your fear, outsmart your enemy, and never yield even to yourself, you will be changed forever.
Yes, you may very well be changed forever, as thousands of our military have learned. This documentary is dedicated to those who served in the U.S. military for the right reasons, who wonder why they are not and never will be the same, why they are sick, and why military leaders, veterans leaders, and the three branches of our government do not assist them in getting medical care and compensation. The majority of our veterans only want to know what is wrong with them, why they became ill, and how they can be made well again. We will focus on the experiments conducted, the documents that support this experimentation, and what must be done to advance the cause of basic human rights for all active duty, guard, reserve, and veterans. For those of you who are not familiar with military experimentation, you are about to get a lesson in history. For to experiment without consent is truly beyond treason.
bomb away.
Atomic veterans include members of the United States Armed Forces who were exposed to ionizing radiation from atomic and nuclear weapons testing during the period beginning with the Trinity blast of July 16, 1945 at Alamogordo, New Mexico, the U.S. cleanup of Nagasaki, Hiroshima, the 235 atmospheric and nuclear weapons test in the Pacific, and Nevada test sites ending with the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty of 1963. The National Association of Atomic Veterans recognizes that civilians, as well as military personnel, were exposed to harmful nuclear material radiation and that many of these personnel have since died as a result of radiation-induced illnesses. Over 382,000 servicemen, as well as civilian personnel, took part in a variety of tests during the Cold War period, when the Atomic Energy Commission, working in conjunction with the Department of Defense, had troops participate in and witness the detonation at various Pacific and Nevada test areas. Most detonations were larger than and emitted considerably more deadly radiation than the two weapons which were employed against Japan at the end of World War II. During the test, various government agencies and departments were interested in learning about the various effects of atomic and nuclear weapons, as well as how these weapons affected the immediate performance of military personnel and equipment. Troops, ships, and various types of equipment were placed from several hundred yards to several miles from the center of each detonation. On many occasions, military personnel performed maneuvers in and around ground zeros without any protective clothing or respiratory devices. Since the end of these tests in 1963, there has been no government-sponsored medical surveillance of test participants, nor any effort to locate these individuals to warn them of potential health threats. Project MKUltra was the codename for the CIA mind control research program lasting from the 1950s to the 1970s. In 1964, the project was renamed MKSearch. MKUltra was started on the order of CIA Director Alan Dulles in April of 1953, largely in response to alleged Soviet, Chinese, and North Korean mind control techniques on U.S. prisoners of war in Korea. Because most of the MKUltra records were deliberately destroyed in 1972 by order of then-director Richard Helms, it is impossible to have a complete understanding of the more than 160 individually funded research projects sponsored by MKUltra and the related CIA programs. Experiments included radiation, LSD. Experiments included dosing CIA employees, military personnel, other government agents, prostitutes, mental patients, and members of the general public with LSD to study their reactions, usually without the subject's knowledge. In the summer of 1975, congressional hearings and the Rockefeller Commission report revealed to the public for the first time that the CIA and the DOD had conducted experiments on both consenting and unwitting human subjects as part of an extensive program to influence and control human behavior through the use of psychoactive drugs such as LSD, mescaline, and other chemical, biological, and psychological means. The report states that no official records were kept regarding the deaths or illnesses of experimentees. A U.S. Army project that ended over 25 years ago is now the subject of much scrutiny. Project White Coat was the Army's code name for a series of germ warfare studies conducted on about 2,300 Seventh-day Adventist servicemen from 1954 to 1973. Now the Army is investigating the long-term effects that the project may have had on its participants. They center on the Seventh-day Adventist Church and the role that it played in the U.S. Army's development of chemical and biological weapons of mass destruction. Under strict secrecy, the U.S. Army established Camp Dietrich outside of Frederick, Maryland during World War II for the sole purpose of developing germ weapons. The program was controlled by the Army's Chemical Warfare Service, a branch that had worked with gas weapons that were used by the U.S. in World War I. The Army began to study both the offensive and defensive aspects of biowarfare. In 1952, the Army Medical Corps stationed a medical unit in Fort Detrick, and in 1954, this unit began using Seventh-day Adventist soldiers in its research, presumably in the defensive aspects of germ warfare. Fort Detrick was home to what became known as Project White Coat, the code name for the group of Seventh-day Adventist soldiers who were used as human guinea pigs in biowarfare research. Agent Orange was the code name for an herbicide developed for the military primarily for use in tropical climates. The purpose of the product was to deny an enemy cover and concealment in dense terrain by defoliating trees and shrubbery where the enemy could hide. The product Agent Orange was a code name for the orange band that was used to mark the drums in which it was stored. The product was tested in Vietnam in the early 1960s and used at the height of the war in 1967 and 1968. Agent Orange was a 50-50 mix of two chemicals known conventionally as 2,4-D and 2,4,5-T. The combined product was mixed with kerosene or diesel fuel and dispersed by aircraft, vehicle, and hand spraying. An estimated 19 million gallons of Agent Orange was used in South Vietnam during the war, potentially affecting 2.5 million Vietnam veterans. On May 5, 1990, Admiral E.R. Zumwalt, Jr., in a classified report, submitted the following. Report to the Secretary of the Department of Veterans Affairs on the association between adverse health effects and exposure to Agent Orange. In that report, he concluded that it was at least as likely as not that the exposure to Agent Orange caused numerous life-threatening, debilitating, and deforming diseases. BZ is the Army's designation of the psychedelic chemical known in military circles as Agent Buzz, or by the Army's chemical code designation of EA-2277. BZ was aerosolized, sprayed from aircraft, and utilized in conventional bombs. The effect of BZ was that it was psychotropic in nature. Over 362 human subjects were experimented upon at Dugway Proving Ground in Utah in 1964 under the code name of Project Dork. Most records of military experiments involving BZ are still classified and unable to be obtained even through the Freedom of Information Act. BZ was an incapacitating agent with paranormal hallucinations that lasted for not just days, but for weeks and months. You may have seen the movie Jacob's Ladder, which depicts effects from the mist sprayed over our military by our Department of Defense. To this date, the Department of Defense continues to deny and stonewall the existence of a Gulf War illness. The Gulf War illness is a cumulative effect of exposure to depleted uranium, chemicals, biologicals, vaccines, petrochemical agents, and parasite diseases such as leishmaniasis. Few people are aware that the Gulf War was yet another example of the Department of Defense's intentional exposure of its own troops to its own deadly weapons. From 1984 through 1989, the U.S. government, with full knowledge of the CDC and the Department of Commerce, sold and transferred to Iraq $4 billion worth of deadly chemical agents, deadly biological agents such as anthrax, Clostridium botulinum, and West Nile fever virus. As a result of the first Gulf War, hundreds of thousands of our military are now sick, and many have died. The official figure of those who served in Operation Desert Shield and Storm is 697,000. The Department of Defense has now declared nearly 250,000 of those troops as permanently disabled. The official position of the Department of Defense is that there are no classified or unclassified documents that exist to prove that chemicals and biologicals were used in the first Gulf War. But in only a 100-hour war, when less than 150 troops died, how do we explain the morbidity and mortality rate of nearly 450,000 of our servicemen and women.
At the time that the Gulf War started, I was the nuclear medical sciences officer, intelligence and covered everything, special operations officer, mobilization officer, training officer for 330th Medical Brigade. That's the largest medical brigade in the U.S. Army. It's an Army Reserve Medical Command under a one-star general.
Dr. Doug Rocky is a U.S. Army health physicist and nuclear medical sciences officer. Dr. Rocky has expertise in nuclear, biological, and chemical warfare operations, microwave radiation, emergency response, decontamination, and battlefield cleanup.
We were the super garbage men. We had to clean up the messes. We had to identify the messes. We had to collect all the garbage. We had to provide the on-site medical care. It's a lot. All the Iraqi equipment, a lot of U.S. equipment, contains radiological components. When those that equipment was blowing up, the radiological materials were released into the environment, exposing and contaminating. And then to top it all off, we used uranium munitions, known as depleted uranium. They've been used back in 1973 by the Israelis against the Egyptians, but during Gulf War I, Desert Shield and Desert Storm, we took it to a totally new level. The use of radioactive materials on the battlefield, deliberately taking tons and tons, actually over 350 tons of solid radioactive materials, and dispersed it across Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, and Iraq. Taking our radioactive waste and throw it in somebody else's backyard. I am considered a disabled veteran. I've got a 40% disability from the United States Department of Veteran Affairs for combat injuries caused by depleted uranium and other exposures.
Lieutenant Colonel John Marks is an A-10 pilot attached to the 303rd Fighter Squadron stationed at Whiteman Air Force Base, Missouri.
The reason it used depleted uranium is it's a very dense, heavy metal, and it's able to penetrate the most armor of any type of material used. It is a very minor amount of radioactivity, but it's not anything that, if as long as it's in its bullet form, it can be stored and it's not any type of hazardous material. Once it hits a vehicle and vaporizes, then it becomes more of a hazardous material that you have to have special handling of that type of thing. But in its normal bullet form, it's not hazardous and because of the depleted uranium. It is highly effective against armor.
We got direct memorandum from the Department of the Army and other Department of Defense officials specifically telling us that not only were uranium munitions a health threat, they were a serious health threat, the contamination. We got direct warnings, famed Los Alamos memorandum, that to make sure and write a report so that uranium munitions can always be used because there's direct concern about the health and environmental effects. We had the warnings. We also had the responsibility to put together all the decontamination guidelines and also what's called the Combat Lifesaver Program. So myself and my team wrote that, which has now been adopted by the Army and is used every day by the Army.
Battlefields and fighting are by nature hazardous to your health. Some hazards are easy to identify and well understood. Soldiers recognize the serious hazards presented by incoming artillery shells and bullets and take appropriate actions. However, some lesser hazards from new technological applications are not so well known and recognized. One of these newer applications is the use of depleted uranium in munitions and equipment armor. Depleted uranium is obtained from uranium ore, which is found throughout the world. In the United States, this ore is mined in New Mexico, Colorado, Wyoming, Utah, and Arizona. Uranium ore contains three isotopes. By weight, 99.28%, which is uranium-238, 0.71%, which is uranium-235, and 0.0058%, which is uranium-234. Of these three isotopes, uranium-235 and uranium-234 are used for nuclear fuel and weapons. Uranium-238 becomes depleted uranium.
This is a Luna model of one DU tank round. This round would be fired by an Abrams tank. If it was actually uranium rather than aluminum, it would be over 10 pounds of solid uranium. What happens, it moves extremely high velocity. The minute it leaves the bore of the gun, it catches fire. So this rod is a burning rod of uranium. It impacts tremendous forces, unbelievable forces, over this very small diameter. And it's like a blowtorch with tremendous forces that punches right through. Now, as this breaks through and goes into anything, can be steel, concrete, sandbag bunkers, wood, or anything, uranium itself is soft. So you have parts of the fragments of uranium breaks off as it enters and goes through. The uranium rod emits alpha, beta, and gamma radiation and X-ray radiation. The alpha particle is a 4.15 MeV particle. That's 4.15 million electron volts. Now, the intercellular voltage, the voltage that your cell operates biologically, is 10 electron volts. So when that cell is bombarded by an alpha particle at 4.5 million electron volts, it doesn't have a good day. We have all kinds of other problems. We have the beta particle and the gamma rays, the X-rays. Now, we've actually measured the ionizing radiation emissions from a DU rod within, say, 4 to 6 inches at over 300 millirems per hour. Now, that radiation is continuous. So you get a fragment of DU into your body that's emitting at over 300 millirems per hour. Or if you're holding the rod in your hand, it's over 300 millirems per hour. And if you got the fragment, then you got the alpha particle in there, which is an extremely hot particle, 4.15 MeV. And we're looking at what we measured, over 10,000 counts per minute. 10,000 disintegrations per minute, 10,000 alpha particles per minute. In fact, in May of 2002, the U.S. Department of Veteran Affairs reported that over 160,000 troops had participated in Gulf War I, the period August of 1990 through the fall of 1991, basically October and November 1991, have been classified as disabled from anywhere from 10 to 100%. Now, my own disability didn't come about until after May of 2002. The count right now is somewhere close to 200,000. When we look at all the troops that have gone into the Persian Gulf region between August of 1990 and May of 2002, when the last formal report was written, the U.S. Department of Veteran Affairs formally acknowledges over 221,000 individuals are labeled as permanently disabled. And over 10,000 are deceased that had service connection disabilities. There's a big difference. There's a 60,000 increase in individuals that are disabled amongst those that served after the fall of 1991. That disability is only due to residual exposures and immunizations that were continued to be given because there was no active combat. There was no active maneuvering. So what's happened? Well, what happened prior to Gulf War I is pre-deployment health physical assessments were not given. And at the completion of Gulf War I, post-deployment health physical assessments were not given, even though we specifically requested it. In my own case, when I came back to get released after completing special projects, I said I was exposed to these. We need to do these tests. And they refused to do them.
I've been a staff scientist at two nuclear weapons laboratories, 5 years at the Lawrence Berkeley Lab, where the Manhattan Project started, and 2 years at the Lawrence Livermore Lab.
Lorraine Murray is an independent scientist who specializes in radiation issues. Her degrees include BS in geology, master's degree in Near Eastern Studies, and has pursued doctoral studies in geosciences at the University of California, Davis.
For the past 5 years, my research is focused on the damaging effects of low-level radiation. The history of depleted uranium goes back to a 1943 declassified memo known as the Groves Memorandum. In this memo, depleted uranium is recommended for development as a poison gas warfare weapon. According to the United Nations Human Rights Commission, which has declared depleted uranium illegal, approximately 17 countries have purchased depleted uranium weaponry from the United States government.
In December of 1992, the director of the United States Army Environmental Policy Institute was ordered to figure out ways to reduce the toxicity of uranium munitions by Assistant Secretary of the Army Walker. In 1995, the director of AEPI told the Secretary of the Army, "We can't reduce the toxicity. It's not possible." The United States Army Common Task Training states very specifically, uranium contamination will make food and water unusable. And yet we use it in combat all over the place. That's why the United Nations Subcommittee on Human Rights had ruled that uranium munitions were an illegal weapon, because they're indiscriminate. They can't be cleaned up, and they last for eternity.
The amount of depleted uranium used in the first Gulf War in 1991 is approximately 340 tons, and this was admitted by the U.S. government. In Yugoslavia, Lord Robertson, who was the head of NATO in 1998, admitted in the public media that the United States had used depleted uranium warheads in every missile used in that invasion. It's estimated that at least 1,000 tons of depleted uranium was used in Afghanistan in 2001, and approximately 2,400 tons were used in Iraq in 2003.
The United Nations Subcommittee on Human Rights, because of the fact that uranium contamination makes food and water unusable, has a permanent effect and can't be cleaned up, and affects not only combatants but non-combatants. It's been ruled an illegal weapon. It was years ago. That's common sense.
We all know that the United States falsely accused Iraq of possessing weapons of mass destruction in 2003. In fact, the United States invaded Iraq and used weapons of mass destruction against the Iraqis. Depleted uranium has a half-life of 4.5 billion years. If we had a pound of depleted uranium now, in 4.5 billion years, there would only be half a pound left. This means that the Middle East and Central Asia and Yugoslavia are contaminated forever.
We're 1st Platoon Charlie Company, and we were part of Operation Iraqi Freedom.
On the battlefield, you gotta have an officer who can think on his feet. We had that.
Lieutenant Walker came to us from ROTC.
It didn't matter if we were in training or in combat. He was right there with us.
He had confidence and dedication.
And wherever he goes, we go.
I'm a military brat. My father spent 24 years in the Army.
Staff Sergeant Bob Jones is a veteran of Desert Storm, a former Army Ranger now retired and disabled due to Gulf War illness. Not only is Bob ill, but his entire immediate family is affected as they all suffer from mycoplasma fermentans incognitus.
During the air campaign, we targeted their chemical, biological, and nuclear facilities. And so we were exposed to chemicals, biologicals, nuclear radiation in the form of depleted uranium, and also direct enriched uranium, or EU, from those nuclear facilities that were bombed and targeted. And many of the coalition, especially guys on the front line, such as my unit and others like us, were in the area of exposure from the fallouts of the coalition bombings. And although this information became widely known as early as 1994, through testimony and release of GAO reports that showed that the meteorological data supported the fact that the downwind plume or fallout from the bombings drifted over a large number of the troops that were forward positioned.
The U.S. military personnel during Gulf War I, just like during the Balkans and in Gulf War II now, were not adequately protected from all of the exposures they had. We know from firsthand experience that the M40 series mask, as confirmed by the United States General Accounting Office, is defective. We know that it leaks when you move your head. We know that none of those, either the M17 series or the M40 series, provides protection against toxic industrial chemicals. No, were they adequately protected? Absolutely not. Was my team adequately protected? Absolutely not. We wore the respirators, and we got sick. Now, what happened? What we confirmed and what we saw during Gulf War I and when I did the research as director of the Depleted Uranium Project, that DU round comes down and it breaks up. We have the spalling, then we have the fire. And we create uranium oxides of different types, some in the ball game the size of cigarette ash and marbles on down to 0.1 micron. This has always been known. When I talked to senior Manhattan Project scientists that were experts in particle physicists, they said, hey, we knew uranium on when it breaks up like this was going to be down in the 0.1, 0.2 micron range. No doubt about it. The gas mask, the respiratory protection issued to the troops, there's no way it can protect against inhalation. Well, that's what happened to myself and my team. We wore the respiratory protection during Gulf War I, inhaled it, and got sick. We wore the respiratory protection when we were doing the Depleted Uranium Project research in Nevada test site. U.S. Department of Energy approved respirators. And we could smell and taste the uranium through the filters.
During our time over there, we started seeing individuals become ill with various symptoms ranging from rashes all over their bodies or certain areas of their bodies to having chronic explosive diarrhea, which in some cases was heavy bleeding accompanied with that. We had and I can speak for myself on this as well, excruciating headaches. The bones and the joints started aching, and there were night sweats, and things only became worse as time progressed. And my unit in particular was deactivated after our return back to Germany in May of 1991. Some of the other individuals started showing up with other diseases, which included several types of cancers, and the neurological problems that many of us suffer from, and degenerative joint bone disease, spine disease, and other manifestations of illnesses that were at that time still unexplained, that caused them to no longer be able to perform their duties as a soldier as they had for so many years. And some of us that conceived children after the war, and I know of at least two individuals where their children were born perfectly healthy according to the hospital, and within 6 months after their return, their hearts literally exploded in their chests.
Thank you.
In the civilian population in southern Iraq, the Iraqi doctors are reporting very large increases in cancer, leukemia, diabetes, immune system disorders, and of course, birth defects in the newborns. The babies are born without a brain, without eyes, without legs, or without arms. Sometimes the baby is born with a cyclops eye, just one eye in the forehead. And each year, these birth defects are more and more severe. Pediatricians now in southern Iraq are reporting that some babies are born without heads or arms. They're just pieces of flesh. Because Iraq is in an arid region with severe dust storms annually, this remobilizes the depleted uranium on the ground and on the battlefields. And so the civilian population will continue to be exposed to increasing levels of DU internally. The severity of the birth defects and radiation-related diseases will increase over time. In fact, depleted uranium is a death sentence.
Individuals are depleted uranium casualties, whether they're civilians or combatants. Doesn't matter where they were, whether they were exposed during manufacturing processes, testing processes, or combat use. One of the things that we're starting to see, we saw the respiratory problems right off the bat. That was predicted by the Groves Memorandum, totally confirmed by my own physicians and totally documented by VA medical records. Then we saw the rashes. Well, what we're having is we have the particulate irritation damage, we have the chemical toxicity damage, and then we have the radiological damage, which is the result of the cancers and the tumors. All of the birth defects, the absolutely confirmed chromosomal aberrations from the ionizing radiation damage to the cells and the tissues, neurological problems, rashes, cataracts, kidney problems. Your life is messed up. As said in the Groves Memorandum, it's going to cause all these health problems, and there is no medical care and treatment. You can't reverse radiation exposure damage to the body.
This represents a depleted uranium particle. The styrofoam ball in the center is millions of atoms of uranium, and the toothpicks are the tracks of the alpha particles that are released from the uranium nucleus. When these pass through the cell, they release tremendous amounts of energy, which cause the cell processes, enzymes, and hormones to malfunction. When there are billions of these distributed throughout a body, they cause diseases in many ways. And that's why Gulf War syndrome is a complex system of diseases caused by malfunctioning of all of the parts and the processes in a cell that make life possible.
Some of the soldiers were losing their mind.
Dennis Kine served in the U.S. Army until 2003 with the rank of Specialist D4. A graduate of the Nuclear, Biological, and Chemical School, today he serves as a veterans advocate. Kine also graduated magna cum laude from San Jose State University.
We bombed on January 17th. We started bombing. We bombed for 45 days. And after 45 days, February 28th, we started a ground invasion, which is said to be the most victorious military operation ever in the history of mankind. Well, it wasn't victorious. We got sick immediately. On March 1st, Lieutenant Colonel Ziem issued a memorandum that stated specifically, we better have somebody advocate for the use of this weaponry, otherwise the environmentalists might get upset. On March 3rd, they called a ceasefire. So from the date Lieutenant Colonel Ziem's memorandum was issued, 2 days later they called a ceasefire on March 3rd, 1991. And on March 8th, another memorandum was issued saying all soldiers in this area should be protected by wearing their safety clothing. So in 1 week's time, they had two memorandums and a ceasefire that pretty much indicated why all the soldiers were sick.
If the American people could only wake up and see what is happening, you know, this is a tragedy. You know, we're not the first victims of war. In many cases, our wounds are invisible. You know, we carry them inside of us. And it's only through specialty testing and specialty diagnostic testing that you can isolate and find these particular mechanisms involved, whether they be chemical, biological, nuclear, or other agents that would cause what has become known as Gulf War illness, Gulf War syndrome, Persian Gulf illness. There is no such thing as a syndrome. This is an overlapping combination of toxic and other exposures that varied from individual to individual depending on where they were at, what they were exposed to, and how long and the duration of their exposures.
In a cubic meter of air, there are 1 billion particles, a tenth of a micron in diameter. An ordinary man breathes 28 cubic meters of air a day. And for that reason, our soldiers, internally contaminated to depleted uranium, have billions of particles of depleted uranium distributed throughout their bodies. DU can be found in all parts of the body. It has been reported in the bladder, in the semen, in the bone marrow, in the lungs, and the brain. Because of the contamination of the semen from the depleted uranium particles, soldiers returning internally contaminate their wives and their partners.
It wasn't so much my illness, but my family was also ill, and they required medical attention and medical treatment, real medical treatment. I retired in June of last year, June 2003. As soon as I retired, my family was completely dropped from the military medical system. In other words, we were enrolled at the Womack Family Practice, and as soon as I retired, we were dropped like a hot potato. And although I begged and pleaded, they would not let my family re-enroll back into the Womack Family Practice. So in essence, my wife was completely cut off from all the medications and all the treatment that she had received for the past 7 years that dealt extensively, because she was also a victim of these exposures that I brought home from the Gulf War, from my equipment and from my personal exposure, as I alluded to earlier, from bodily contact. And that to me is the greatest travesty. I just can't imagine how a nation, not only will they take care of their veterans that have returned from war, but you have innocent family members and loved ones that never put their hand up and swore allegiance to fight and defend the Constitution of the United States, and they get kicked to the curb and nobody cares.
When you get these health effects, you have to prove to the United States Department of Veteran Affairs that you were exposed. And then you have to prove that the health effects that you're seeing were caused by the exposures you have. But it's very difficult to do when the medical records have been destroyed, the personnel files have been missing or destroyed. And when you got senior Department of Defense officials continue to state, well, none of these guys are sick. None of these guys are dead. Why don't you ask Sue Reardon someday about Terry? Why don't you ask Sue Sitton someday about John? Or Frank Zuli? Or Mr. Kiefer. Ask his granddaughter why she'll never enjoy her grandfather. And look at the Iraqi women and children and men. Ask the question yourself. Is winning a battle but contaminate air, water, soil, and food worth the life of your son and daughter? Is it worth the life of the child? Not just those that are alive, but those that are going to be exposed because the contamination remains there for eternity. It's real simple. I was tasked to clean up the uranium munitions by name, by order, during Gulf War I. I was assigned as the Depleted Uranium Project Director. I did the research. I prepared the programs. I wrote the regulations for management. I wrote the procedures for management. And I got sick because I served my nation. And I was discarded. I was abandoned.
Depleted uranium weapons are designed not only to kill the enemy, devastate the civilian population for generations to come, but DU weapons also destroy the environment and damage the economy. In 1996, the United Nations passed a resolution that made DU illegal under international law. In order to protect themselves and continue the illegal usage of depleted uranium, the United States government has co-opted the International Criminal Court, thus protecting certain individuals from war crimes charges. Unbeknownst to most U.S. citizens and unreported in the U.S. media was the International Criminal Tribunal for Afghanistan held at Tokyo, Japan, December 15th of 2002. Those meetings lasted for over a year. The initial complaint presented for the tribunal charges George Bush with 31 counts of war crimes, violations of the Geneva Conventions, and other crimes against peace in the war on Afghanistan. In addition to the original 31 war crime charges against George Bush, the judges and tribunal recommended two additional charges. Number one, Bush knowingly used depleted uranium on the battlefield against his own troops, and number two, that it was, in fact, a crime against the environment.
The United States Army, USAMRIID, Fort Detrick, Maryland, sold and provided the chemical and biological munitions and anthrax spores to Iraq. That's totally confirmed in the Regal Commission report written by James Toot and the subject of a made-for-TV movie called Thankful Grateful Nation that starred Ted Danson and Mark Helgenberger.
The United States has a long-standing involvement in the sale of weapons to third world countries. Donald Rumsfeld, a private citizen, met with Saddam Hussein as a political envoy of the Reagan administration on December 20th of 1983. It is a little-known fact that he was also president and CEO of the G.D. Searle Pharmaceutical Company. According to Howard Teicher, author of Twin Pillars to Desert Storm, he and Rumsfeld traveled to Baghdad on December 17th in order to lay the groundwork
for the presumption of full diplomatic relations between the United States and Iraq. Prior to that time, Iraq was on the known list of terrorist countries. Iraq invaded Iran in September of 1980. It is important to note that the ban on the sale of weapons was in force until 1982, when it was lifted with the strong objections from Congress. The U.S. began the transfer of helicopters to Iraq in December of 1982. In 1983, Banco Nazionale del Lavoro of Italy and its branch in Atlanta began to funnel $5 billion in unreported loans to Iraq with the blessing and official approval of the U.S. government. The Reagan administration began secretly allowing Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, and Egypt to transfer United States weapons, including howitzers, Huey helicopters, and bombs to Iraq. These shipments violated the Arms Export Control Act. From 1985 through 1989, the Department of Commerce licensed 70 biological exports to Iraq, including approximately 21 batches of lethal strains of anthrax, shipments of weapons-grade Clostridium botulinum, and West Nile fever virus. In April of 1988, the Department of Commerce approved the shipment of chemicals used in the manufacture of mustard gas. The U.S., with the approval of the CDC and the Department of Commerce, armed Iraq illegally from 1985 through 1989.
We knew from the fact that Iraq had got chemical and biological weapons from the United States and used them on Iraqi Kurds and on the Iranians, that they didn't have them in their possession, they would probably use them. We knew that all the toxic industrial chemicals that we use in the military, when we move a military go into combat, were going to affect everybody. We knew that all of the other weapon systems we had have a horrible health and environmental effect on the battlefield. That's history. And with all the background all of us had, both within the military and within academia, it was very easy for us to understand and predict what was going to happen. During the period of 1990 and 1991, we made a conscious decision, and this decision was a decision made between General Powell, General Schwarzkopf, General Horner, and Secretary Cheney to blow up Iraq's chemical and biological stockpiles in place. We also decided to blow up their nuclear reactors in place. This is all confirmed in Schwarzkopf's autobiography, It Doesn't Take a Hero, on page 390. For somebody who wants to look, you can go find out for yourself. At that time, we warned everybody that these exposures, downwind exposures, were going to have a disastrous effect on U.S. military personnel, on coalition personnel, on Iraqi personnel, and on the civilians and non-combatants in the region. That warning was ignored.
The average military person had no knowledge that the United States was secretly and illegally continuing to sell weapons of mass destruction to Iraq just prior to Operation Desert Shield and Desert Storm. It is important to note that these biological materials were not attenuated or weakened and were capable of reproduction, thus illustrating these biological agents were not for research, but for the purpose of weaponization. Not even the military medical personnel tasked with treating the wounded on the battlefield had any training regarding a biological or chemical casualty. According to Senate Report 103-900, by the time of the invasion of Kuwait, Iraq had developed biological weapons. The Riegel Report states that Iraq's biological warfare program was the most advanced in the Arab world. There is substantial evidence to suggest that the Iraqi military used the Soviet doctrine of multiple chemicals and multiple biologicals against our troops. This serves to confuse the diagnostic and treatment process and would account for the wide variety of symptoms displayed by Gulf War veterans.
Most of the guys that I served with are either severely disabled or dead due to the fact of their exposure to the different elements that were involved.
Michael is a veteran of Desert Storm and served in the area of special operations. Because of fear of reprisal by the Department of Defense or loss of his veterans' benefits, he has requested that we alter his voice and image.
One memory that sticks very clearly in my mind is the chemical alarms. At least once a day, we'd have a chemical alarm go off. And after a while, we learned to pay attention to them because we were told it was a malfunction. They would try and tell us that either it had blown paint on it, some fumes from something that had been painted nearby had been blown on it and that set it off, and so on and so forth. And it makes me wonder, you know, they claim that no chemical weapons were used, but I have every reason to believe that now, in retrospect, it's so sad that you trust them so much that when the chemical alarm goes off, and most normal human beings would go, well, I don't care what you say, that chemical alarm goes off, I'm going to take precautions. But you are so indoctrinated in the fact that, oh, well, we're here to look out for you, we're going to take care of you, that when the chemical alarms go off, you just sit there and continue eating or reading or whatever it was you were doing.
On a number of occasions, chemical alarms went off, and we were ordered not to basically respond to them or report them or write down statistics or even study the environment we were in, which is normally what an NBC person would do. Once an alarm goes off, you start putting, you know, testing things around to see if there's anything happening. At the first call of an alarm, we would be told a number of different things, like it was the gasoline setting it off, or it was the oil well fires burning that was setting it off, or it could have been anything other than an actual chemical or biological agent. Surely wasn't. Don't worry about it, soldier. You'll be okay.
We had alarms going off, chemical alarms, and there were several occasions where we had to go into full mop gear in the middle of the night, or especially in the middle of the night. It's unbelievable that we had all this equipment that had been calibrated and sent over there prior to the war, and we had set out monitors in the perimeter and in the area to detect any kind of chemical activity. However, what is of significant and monumental importance is the fact that we had no biological detection capabilities over there whatsoever. And this all relates back to the fact that we destroyed their chemical biological sites and also the bunker complexes, not to mention the big one in Kamisea, which is the only one that got any kind of real attention due to the fact that an individual or several individuals happened to film the contents of that bunker complex. The order was given to blow the place up rather than the normal procedures when you find a place like that magnitude holding the contents that it did. There were other means of disposal. The area was secured, and what surprises me is the fact that we received no warning. No one was instructed to get into any kind of mop gear or any type of chemical protective posture, although it's questionable whether it would have helped anyway.
Well, we were issued, you know, mop suit military occupational protective posture is what MOP stands for. Mop suits, we were issued them, but they were useless to us after the first 3 days after we opened the package. So you get in country, they issue you a brand new suit, it's got a charcoal filter in it, but the minute that, you know, package has been opened and that suit has been liberated, that suit is useless. You can't keep putting it on and taking it off.
The Department of Defense has long touted that American troops are the best prepared, trained, and equipped in the world. Unfortunately, the equipment that was meant to save their lives may very well have cost them their health in Desert Shield and Storm. Information has now been obtained that proves that the chemical suits sold to the Department of Defense during 1989 were in fact useless. Isratex, A company from Rainier, West Virginia, sold nearly 800,000 defective suits that later proved to be full of tears, holes, and poor stitching. One hole can mean the life or death of a soldier during a chemical exposure. The company subsequently filed for bankruptcy, and its owners have never faced accountability for their actions. The Camisea Bunker Complex is estimated to be 100 bunkers and 60 warehouses, each the size of a super Walmart. The destruction of Camisea was not even discussed until June of 1996, when it was addressed by Senator Specter at the Senate Armed Forces hearing. General Schwarzkopf said the following.
As I stated, the first time I ever heard of Camisea was in 1996 when it was first announced by the Department of Defense, and nobody was more surprised than I was.
A little later in his testimony, General Schwarzkopf apparently contradicted himself when he said the following.
I remember General Franks came to me, and I assume it was Camisea he was talking about at the time, because it was about the same time frame, and talked about this huge ammunition dump that they had found with literally tons and tons and tons of ammunition in it, and there was no way they could possibly retrograde it. And I challenged him on that, and he convinced me that no, they couldn't retrograde it, and therefore they were going to destroy it in place. And I said, fine, now that's Camisea. From what I heard about the size of the bunker that Franks was talking about and the others that they blew up, these were huge bunkers with crates and crates and crates and crates of ammunition in them. And I can only assume that they either didn't recognize them or didn't see them at the time. We were under pressure to withdraw. And under the pressures of withdrawal, we did destroy everything we could so that the Iraqis couldn't fall back in on it and use it in some other war against us.
General Schwarzkopf just stated that he was concerned about the Iraqis regaining control of the ammunition that was contained at the Camisea Ammunition Depot. However, several individuals have come forward with other reasons as to why the bunker depots were hastily destroyed.
I'm Dan Topolsky. I was the Nuclear Biological and Chemical Defense NCO for B Company, 37th Engineer Battalion. I was on the Camisea Bunker Complex mission.
Sergeant Topolsky was one of the nuclear, biological, and chemical non-commissioned officers in charge of identifying munitions at Camisea Bunker Complex in Iraq.
I felt betrayed. I felt like we had been sold out for dollars when I saw what I saw inside those bunkers.
Even though I had 40-some years in the military service, if you were to bring in a bunch of ammunition and pile it up in front of me, and one of them was a 122-millimeter rocket with chemicals in it, I would not be able to tell you that that had chemicals in it. Particularly if it was an Iraqi rocket with Arabic writing on it or something of the sort. We identify ours when we had them in a very specific way by color coding. I don't have the slightest idea what the Arabs did.
General Schwarzkopf stated that we identified our weapons by color coding. According to Sergeant Topolsky, the colored bands identified biological and chemical munitions inside the Camisea bunker complex. According to Sergeant Topolsky, the yellow or purple bands indicate chemical munitions. The green bands represent biological munitions. General Schwarzkopf also said he could not identify munitions, especially if they had Iraqi markings on them. You will also note these munitions were plainly marked in English and indicated these munitions were supplied by countries like Jordan, England, Russia, as well as the United States of America. According to the 1972 Geneva Convention, weapons of mass destruction are illegal. Therefore, according to Sergeant Dan Topolsky, it is very likely that these munitions were destroyed not so much to prevent Saddam Hussein from regaining control of them, but to destroy the evidence of these countries breaking international law.
The 37th Engineer Battalion, way back in the air campaign, was ordered by our battalion commander not to wear our protective overgarments unless specifically told to do so. My company pretty much ignored that order because my company commander supported me when I said that that was dead wrong and he's going to wind up with a dead company if he listens to it. Now, a lot of the other companies in the battalion didn't do that.
On April 17, 1997, General Colin Powell testified before the same Senate panel, and as was the case of General Schwarzkopf, he was not required to take the oath to tell the truth. In regard to the chemical mop suit, General Powell
said the following.
We used protective overgarments, boots, masks. I don't think you have seen a single battle scene from the Desert Storm War where our troops were not in mop gear.
Well, the Department of Defense officials continue to lie about what we know and what happened during Gulf War I, but it's real simple. The chemical agent alarms went off. There was no other reason for them to go off. The individuals got sick. There's no other reason for them to get sick. And medical tests, my own medical tests, confirm, absolutely confirm, the sarin and cyclosarin exposures, for which I had been notified directly by the Deputy Secretary of Defense by name in a personal letter that, hey, Doug, you got exposed to sarin and cyclosarin because you're downwind from Kamacia. But Kamacia was only one of over 100 sites that we deliberately blew up after the completion of the ground war from March through the fall of 1991.
Even though the Department of Defense continues to deny the widespread use of chemicals and biologicals during the first Gulf War, Jonathan Tucker of the Monterey Institute of International Studies has demonstrated evidence for the use of chemicals in the Kuwaiti Theater of Operations. The U.S. intelligence reports show the presence of Iraqi chemical weapons. Military log entries describe the discovery of chemical munitions in Iraqi bunkers during and after the ground war. There are incidents in which troops reported acute, numerous symptoms of toxic chemical exposure. There's credible detections of chemical warfare agents made by Czech, French, and American forces. Chemical warfare agents that were detected by coalition forces during the Gulf War include the nerve agent Tabin, sarin, cyclosarin, and the blister agents sulfur, mustard, and lewisite. To this date, there has been no diagnosis or treatment offered by the Department of Defense or Veterans Administration. Dr. Robert Haley, MD of the University of Texas Southwestern Medical School in Dallas, Texas, has detected damage in the brains of those Gulf War veterans who were near the explosion of Kamacia. Those injuries had resulted in not only increased social problems, but also a 90% divorce rate and increase crime rates among those vets who show damage in the area of the brain that controls judgment. The children of Gulf War veterans have shown increased defects such as Goldenhar syndrome, a missing eye or ear, major organ or digestive deformities, and general failure to thrive. 13 years after the Gulf War, the Department of Defense still calls the Gulf War illness a mystery disease. Either the Pentagon employs the most incompetent researchers and physicians in the world, or the cover-up is by design that these troops are being denied meaningful medical care. We can only conclude that the Department of Defense is waiting for an army to die.
The threat of biological warfare is nothing new to the military, but the Persian Gulf War placed a special emphasis on it. This renewed emphasis caused the Defense Department to look at how it was protecting men and women in uniform from this battlefield threat, this unseen enemy. Staff Sergeant Noah Berg looks at one of those enemies and what is being done to fight it.
The Defense Department says it can be a big threat on the modern battlefield. Anthrax, most commonly associated with livestock. And the type that worries those military leaders most is the type that is inhaled.
Sometimes people refer to as very early stages as something like a common cold. But then the person goes downhill very quickly.
Because of the potential anthrax threat, last year the Defense Department ordered vaccinations. And one of the first in line was Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, Eric Behnken. Despite isolated protests, the vast majority of medical experts endorse the vaccine's use. And despite charges that the so-called Gulf War syndrome and anthrax are connected, Huxel says that's just not true. The Defense Department continues to stress the safety of the anthrax vaccine, and all troops headed for the Persian Gulf receive the inoculation series.
We had all the problems from immunizations. Our team was tasked with to put together the anthrax vaccine program in theater. But we were also ordered, do not record lots, batches, doses, who got them, what their reactions were, when they got them, or how many they got. Direct orders.
There's enough paperwork right now to prove there is a Gulf War illness, and there's certain medicines that control it, and that's all they're doing right now is controlling it for a few.
Staff Sergeant Mark Zeller was a member of Special Operations in the 18th Airborne Corps. He served in the Iraq-Iran War, Desert Shield, and Desert Storm campaigns.
We're all forced to roll up our sleeves and pull down our pants and get shots in the gluteus and in the tricep muscles of our arms. We all started getting sick, but we didn't think nothing of it because our flight surgeon was telling us that it's hygiene that's getting us. We're all not taking baths every day. It's like maybe once a week or once every 3 days. And that hygiene was supposedly getting the best of us, so we didn't think anything of it after that.
They punched us with all these different vaccines, supposedly to protect us, and knowing that, you know, some of these had never been tested on humans.
My neck bones are degenerating. My lower back's degenerating. No one knows why. They want to go in there and scrape it and biopsy it. I'm like, I don't want to be in a wheelchair afterwards. It's pretty damaging to a guy that used to be in special operations and jumped out of airplanes for a living. So.
The use of vaccines in the military with recruits and servicemen and women is well documented. What is not well known is the relationship between the Department of Defense and pharmaceutical companies who have a vested interest in the widespread use of vaccines. What is contained in the vaccines, and just how many of those vaccines that were given that were in fact experimental. The experimentation of individual military members by the bureaucracy of the military medical establishment crosses all party lines. Military experimental use of vaccines have been conducted during the past 50 years. The senior Bush administration ordered the use of experimental vaccines, anthrax and botulinum, during the buildup of the first Gulf War. The Clinton administration ordered the experimental use of the tick-borne encephalitis vaccine in Bosnia. Perhaps one of the most devastating executive orders regarding vaccines came under the Clinton administration. Executive Order 13139 essentially orders the use of experimental vaccines and/or drugs at any time without the service member's consent to be given to anyone in the military as long as the President or the Secretary of Defense approves. During the first Gulf War, it was not unusual for a service member ordered to Iraq in 1991 to receive 10 to 17 vaccines in one setting. Thousands of U.S. and coalition military personnel who served in the Persian Gulf War are now seriously incapacitated from unknown causes. One common thread for all military personnel were the vaccines. Many of those who did not deploy became ill also. Unfortunately, the U.S. military medical establishment has continued to conduct on an ongoing basis operations such as Project Badger and that has been referred to as a Manhattan-like project that involved the Tri-Service Vaccine Task Force. Credit for the best vaccine research should go to Gary Matsumoto in his acclaimed book entitled Vaccine A. Matsumoto concludes that the government covertly experimented on troops using squalene which is an oil-based booster used to make vaccines stronger. Squalene has only been approved for use in experimental AIDS and experimental malaria vaccines. Since a large percentage of U.S. forces tested positive for squalene, it has led many individuals to believe that the anthrax vaccine could have been a primary clinical trial for an AIDS vaccine experiment. What the DOD should have disclosed to the troops is that squalene causes life-threatening diseases such as lupus, crippling arthritis, and multiple sclerosis. On May 11, 1999, at an Air Force briefing held at Dover Air Force Base, Air Force Surgeon General Charles H. Rodman II denied the use of squalene in the anthrax vaccine. He was backed up by Army Colonel Arthur Friedlander. However, 6 weeks later, the FDA identified the presence of squalene in two separate vaccine lots. With the reintroduction of the anthrax vaccine prior to the Second Gulf War, up to 50% of Air National Guard pilots resigned rather than take the deadly vaccine. To this date, the Department of Defense continues to give the anthrax vaccine to U.S. military.
The minute you walk into a recruiter's office, the first thing they say is, young man, if you do this, you'll be taken care of forever. And in modern day, the 21st century soldier, it includes women. So men and women are promised health care should they become sick from the battlefield. And the fact of the matter is that since Operation Desert Storm concluded, 10 to 11,000 soldiers are dead. 250,000 of us get a check from the Veterans Administration for undiagnosed illnesses. And double that amount have actually gone to the Veterans Administration and entered into study groups known as ionizing radiation study groups and Gulf War depleted uranium study groups. And that's just being used as a guinea pig. So we were abused by the Department of Defense. We got sent to a contaminated battlefield. We came home, we were being studied by the Veterans Administration. And every time we turn around and look for some help, somebody calls us a post-traumatic stress disorder. And that's not appropriate. We're not stressed out, we're sick. We've been contaminated. I do what I do every day because the system hurt me.
Phyllis, you're on the air with Dennis Kine. Go ahead, please.
I just want to take time, Dennis, to thank you so much and be able to say this personally to you. And I want to urge the folks to order your book. And I can't go at the pace that I used to, and I'm so thankful for someone like you to help some of us old-timers.
It hurt me as a soldier, and it hurt me as a veteran. And I don't want to see anybody else get hurt. I don't do this because I need to inflict any pain on anybody. I do this because young men and women enter voluntarily into a system to go serve their country, serve their friends, serve their family, and serve their fellow Americans, and they get duped by the recruiter from the very beginning when they're told, if you get injured or become sick, we will take care of you. And for 14 years, I've been a prime example. My family members, my brothers, are prime examples of people who never got cared for.
There's legislation in Congress right now to implement another draft. Every parent needs to decide if they're willing to send their child to be part of a military medical establishment experimentation process, because that's exactly what is going to take place. For the past 50 years, we've been experimenting upon hundreds of thousands of our military. It's incomprehensible the damage that has taken place in the lives of these servicemen and women. And it's not just the servicemen and women, it's their families, their spouses, their children that have been severely affected. It must stop. How will we ever get anyone to join the military knowing that they're going to be exposed to whatever the Department of Defense desires to do with them? Once people are aware of the massive amount of experimentation that takes place in our military, we won't have one. We won't have a group of people that will serve. And for obvious reasons. Because of the Ferris Doctrine, which has blocked any kind of compensation, assistance, or really any accountability from the Department of Defense or the military, our troops are living in some kind of slippery slope. They have no rights. With Executive Order 13139, they can be experimented upon without their consent, anytime, any place. When will it stop? How will it stop? And what must we do?
One of the, I think, problems with American law is that there is a number of ways that municipalities, states, and the federal government will often immunize themselves from what would normally be seen as tort actions. In the United States, we have something called the Ferris Doctrine, which essentially articulates a rule of sovereign immunity that says the federal government is not liable for anything that happens to you while you are in military service. The doctrine originates from the year 1950, and the court at that time heard the case of a military serviceman who was killed in a barracks fire, and ultimately decided that it was good public policy not to allow these lawsuits.
This really is the ultimate in hypocrisy. You see the heroic search and rescue missions where the government is very publicly going in and rescuing prisoners of war in combat. And the message there, or the propaganda, if you will, is that we care about you, the soldier. The reality is very different. The reality is that they are shielding themselves behind an outdated legislation and using the soldiers essentially as pawns in a chess game.
The Ferris case was literally about a serviceman who was injured in a barracks fire in New York State. That's a very different kind of case than the subsequent cases that have been brought to the Supreme Court. A case like Depleted Uranium or Agent Orange or something like the Tuskegee experiment, this is about the government knowingly allowing you to be injured. Some would argue intentionally allowing it to happen, certainly behaving through gross negligence to allow you to suffer injury to yourself. And the courts have consistently, for the last five decades, upheld this as a legal doctrine that is alive and well in this country. Now, recently, in the late 1980s, ironically, one of the most conservative justices, Justice Scalia, has indicated in a decision where he was joined by three other justices that the Ferris Doctrine was wrongly decided. And so there's some hope that the court is starting to see that a doctrine that began over the principle of negligence ought not be applied when you get into really criminal knowledge.
BeyondTreason.com will be a focal point, an area where people can go to find out what can be done, what needs to be done, and how to help. We must all join together to say, enough is enough. You see, if they experiment upon the military, the citizens are next. We can no longer play the role of esprit de corps in the military, of patriotism, of blind patriotism. We must accept the fact that it is our fault that we have allowed this to take place in this country. We call ourselves Americans, and this is freedom, and yet our sons and daughters are dying. Those that are responsible for these acts should spend the rest of their natural lives in prison for what they have done. There is no question, from the presidents on down for the past 50 years, those that have been in charge of these experiments, there is no question that this is truly beyond treason.